Give me. Good morning, everybody. Hope everybody's had a very good week through all the struggles with this virus and things going on in our nation and all these things. I hope everybody has done well this week. And I just want to welcome everybody. I'm glad all y'all are here. And I'm going to go through a few announcements, but any announcements I don't mention, they're in the bulletin. And any questions, be sure to call the church office or you can refer to our website for the bulletin. But these are the ones I wanted to share today. First of all, Charge Conference is going to be on October 11th, next Sunday, at 2:30 p.m. in the sanctuary. If you cannot attend and want the online link, please call the church office. Secondly, Joyful Noise will be next Sunday, and we're going to be donating to the West Texas Food Bank, which I personally feel is a wonderful place to donate. So bring your change, and then, of course, the buckets will be here, and you can put them in the buckets next Sunday. Thirdly, Pastor Raúl will not be in town from October the 5th through the 8th. He will be at a pastor's retreat in Sacramento, New Mexico. If you have any needs, be sure to call the church office. And finally, United Methodist men will meet on Saturday, 10-10, this next Saturday, 10-10 of 20 at 8 a.m. All right, that's the announcements. And so, I have a different adjective today. God is awesome all the time. And all the time, God is awesome. So, I want to pray for our nation and all the prayer concerns. So, join me in the opening prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for having us come. Thank you for giving us the strength and the health and the well-being to be the church today. Help us all realize we all love you, we all accept you, and we're thankful we have you in our lives. And Lord, I ask to pray for our nation. I pray for the Trumps who, as y'all have heard, have been diagnosed with the COVID virus, but both of them, praise the Lord, are asymptomatic and healthy. And I pray that they get taken care of in a proper manner. And Lord, along with that, I pray for our nation. I pray that we keep our liberties and our freedoms and our pursuit of happiness after the election this year, that we don't lose all of those and that we're not being dictated by people who are really no better than any of us are. And that's the biggest prayer I have right now. And also, Lord, I want to pray for everybody on our bulletin who has prayer needs and concerns. I ask you to lift them up, their family members, their friends up, everybody and caregivers, everybody who's involved with taking care of them. And Heavenly Father, I pray our lesson today will be one, our church service and even Sunday school lesson will be one lessons that we take through our week and through the rest of our lives. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, church. As we begin our first Sunday in October, and this month we're going to be talking about ecclesia and what it means to be the church, I invite you to stand with me as you're able. As we sing, please keep your masks on, and we will start out this month with hymn 558, We Are the Church, and we'll be singing verses 1, 2, and 4.
The church is not a resting place.
Would y'all join me in the affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed? In the Pew Bible, it's on page 881. We believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Good morning, everyone, and good morning to all the kids who are watching our service from home. As I've been saying before, the fact that we don't see many kids here at church, although we have some of them, it doesn't mean that we don't have any kids. We have kids watching, and we have a guest speaker today for our children's moment. It's a friend of ours, a church member. Her name is Randolyn Welch. And she prepared the children's moment for today. So I invite you to see this video, and I hope you like it.
Open the doors to all the people.
So what is the first thing that comes to your mind when you think of the church? Is it the church building with a steeple? Some of you may have thought of this beautiful church building that we have been blessed with. And while this building enables us to reach many people and do many things, it is just a building. It is merely wood and bricks and windows and doors and other building materials. But what did we see earlier when we opened everything up? It is what's inside the church building that's what's important. Your family, and my family, and all of the other church families, God says that we are the church. And so especially right now, when we're not spending as much time in this church building as we're accustomed to, but always, it is important to remember that we are the church.
So what are some ways that we can remember to be the church in our community? First, treat everyone that we encounter with kindness. Pray for others. Pray for those who are sick and those who are taking care of them. Check in on our neighbors and friends. Remind them that Jesus loves them. Donate when we have plenty, especially to others who may be in need when things are hard to find. Look for other opportunities to help as we are able, and let our teachers know how much we appreciate them working to continue our education while keeping us safe at the same time. I challenge you to find a way to be the church next week.
Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for all of our church families, whether they be here in our building or joining us from home, or wherever else they may be. We thank you for this opportunity to remember that we are your church, Lord. We ask that you help us to remember that during the coming week and help us to identify opportunities to do your work. We pray for all of those struggling with sickness and their families and everyone else who has been affected by this pandemic in other ways. Please keep us safe as we go forward and watch over our friends and family. In your name we pray, Amen.
Bye, kids. Have a blessed week.
Now, let me share something with you real quick. We had some kids who actually completed the challenge from last month, and they have some prizes coming their way, the mystery prizes. And we're going to keep our kids engaged and challenged through these months and weeks, and I hope the more we get, it'll be better. So we'll show you all the pictures and celebrations of the kids doing the challenges and sending us their pictures. But our church keeps going, and we definitely are reaching out to our younger members of the church. So please keep the children's ministry in your prayers as we continue navigating these waters and knowing that God is still faithful. So thank you, and God bless you.
All right. We appreciate everybody's giving and tithes and offerings to this church. And anything we can do to help others, we're glad we can do that. There are baskets outside. Everybody saw them. And you can put your tithes or offerings in there. Or you can give online. Or you can even mail them to the church. Or finally, it's like some of us, we drop it underneath the church office door. And you can even do that. So anyway, there's several different ways to give, and I think we need to thank every one of y'all for your gifts to this church, and we will pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for all you've done for us. You are awesome. You are extremely awesome, and we have a lot to be thankful for that we have you in our lives. And Heavenly Father, I pray that as much as you give to us, that we can give at least a portion back for your kingdom and for the love of others. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Please stand with me for the singing of the doxology.
If you haven't had the chance to walk around the foyer, I encourage you to do it when we're done here today. You will find many pictures, old church directories, memories of the past that we are acknowledging and celebrating today in our church. And we've also encouraged you, in case you have a nice picture of you, long ago with friends, that you had a good meal here, a potluck, or something that you want to bring and show us and be displayed. Because we're celebrating the fact that we're still here. We've had a rough year. But the whole month of October, we'll be talking about church and how we are the church, as we've been singing. Now, one of the things that we've talked about is how important prayer is for us. And again, we encourage you to keep sending us your prayer requests. And be specific. If you want us to add it to the prayer list, we will. We've been praying for many things here, and we will continue praying for those things. So take those cards you have in your pews. Fill those. Let us know what's going on, how we can pray for you. We want to be praying for you. And as we heard, we're always praying for our nation, our schools, our teachers, our students, our churches. In these interesting times that we are living, we are not forgetting about the fact that God is in control, that He will walk us through this rough path. And hopefully it won't last long. But today I would like to invite you to join me in prayer and picture God right in front of you again. The closer we picture ourselves coming to Him, it is so tempting to see God so far away when He's really so close. So I invite you, join me in this prayer. in this time of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you today for your presence in this place. Lord, we thank you for the fact that it doesn't matter how long our week has been, how tired we can be, or what emotions we may bring, we know that we can come to your house and experience your love. God, we pray that you take all the distractions that may present themselves in our minds, in our hearts today, away from us. And we also pray that you will take all those burdens that we constantly carry on our shoulders. God, today we begin a new chapter in our sermon series to talk about the church. And God, we know that we don't own this place, that we are your church, that you, Lord, are the head. And God, we come to worship you every Sunday. We come to be closer to you. We come to pray to you, hoping to hear an answer. We know you're faithful. We know you love us. We know you have sustained us. God, we come together today to give you honor and glory, to thank you for the many blessings that you keep giving us every single day. God, we come today together to thank you for your grace and your mercy. And we join millions of people around the world who at this very moment are praying with us to you. As today, Lord, it's celebrated this special Sunday of World Communion in the United Methodist Church. We know there's many churches around the world who are about to celebrate one of the most beautiful things that we have in our church, and it's the unity that we can experience through you. And God, today we come and pray for our brothers and sisters who are sick, those who are having a hard time, those who are dealing with COVID, those who are going through an illness, treatment, therapy, whatever the case is. Lord, we pray for all those whose names are printed in the bulletin, all those whose names are being written in those cards. We pray, God, for your mighty hand to be at work in their lives. God, we believe that you have the power to heal. We believe that if we ask in Jesus' name, you will hear our prayers. So, Father, hear our prayers today as we ask you to bring healing to those who have been struggling for a while, for those who just learned and found out that they have cancer, for those who just heard that they don't have much time to live, for those who have been diagnosed with the virus. Be with those who may be going through a difficult time with their health. God, we pray for those who are out of town and traveling. We always pray for your protection. We pray for those, Lord, today. We pray for those who are struggling and mourning and grieving right now the loss of someone they love. Just in our community, there's been a great loss with a family of our sister churches in Odessa. We have experienced loss as a community, and it just seems like it's all around us. But God, we just pray that your Holy Spirit will surround us with peace, with joy, and that you will be our protector. God, we pray for our nation. We pray for the unity of our nation in you. Let us be a nation that loves you and seeks your face daily. God, let us be a church that is united. Let us see our teachers and students growing in their faith and their knowledge and their wisdom as we continue to swim against the current. We need your strength and your hope. And Lord, that's why we're here. So we pray in the name of Jesus Christ that today will be a special day for us, that we will not leave this place the same way we came. If we came with sorrow, pain, God, we just pray for joy and a big smile on our faces. If we came here with a smile on our faces, we pray that as we leave, it'll be even bigger and more contagious for those who are around us. Fill our cup is our prayer. And today we join in this beautiful prayer that you have left us through your Son, our Lord Jesus. And together we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our hymn of preparation this morning is number 593, Here I Am, Lord. And I invite you to remain seated as we sing this song together, offering ourselves to our God and preparing our hearts to hear from his word this morning.
Our scripture lesson this morning comes from Psalm 122, and in the Pew Bible, I don't have the page, I'm sorry, but Psalm 122, it's verses 1 through 9, and here we go. I was glad when they said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Our feet are standing within your gates, O Jerusalem. Jerusalem, built as a city that is bound firmly together. To it the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, as was decreed for Israel, to give thanks to the name of the Lord. For there the thrones of judgment were set up, the thrones of the house of David. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May they prosper who love you. Peace be within your walls and security within your towers. For the sake of my relatives and friends, I will say, peace be within you. For the sake of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek your good. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Please stand with me as we sing the Gloria Patri in response.
I never thought this would be me. 203. I stood up there thinking, I can do it. It's no big deal. Then my knees started shaking and my heart skipped a beat. 203. I took a breath. And as I was about to start, my voice broke, and then I cried. 2003. People were watching. It wasn't nice. How did I get here? This too shall pass. 203. Those are the days that have passed since the first time I heard the words, the church will be closed. Those are the number of days that have passed since I first stood up before an empty building, an empty church, and the lens of a camera. 203. That's a long time. That is 30 Sundays wearing a mask. No hugs and no shaking hands. Not having a choir. Not having fellowship meals. And it's actually weird because I'm gaining weight instead of losing weight. That's 7 Sundays in which we have celebrated Holy Communion in a different way. 203 days in which we have lost dear friends and we haven't been able to say goodbye in the proper way. 203 days. Have you wondered what's next? As a pastor, I do. What's next? How long is this going to, you know, how much more of this do we have? How is church going to look like when all this is over? When things go back to normal? And what if it's true what they're saying, that there's going to be a new normal? How is that going to look like? Will people come back to our worship service? See, I've been reading around and I've been doing some research of church experts, and they have their perspectives and their theories of how church is going to look like after this pandemic is gone. And they have different theories. There's people who say, you know, the church is going to be in a rough spot. Things are not going to be the same. People are not going to come back as we are hoping. And this online thing will become the new normal. People will choose to stay home and worship from home instead of coming back. And there's others who say, oh, the minute that all the restrictions are lifted, people are going to come back. And they are going to come back to the pews and enjoy every minute of the worship service. Because we've been craving for it. There's different theories. There's different analysis. Some are scary, some are encouraging. But what about you? What about you? What is church to you? As you notice, I've had people ask me when they saw the sermon topic in the bulletin, is like, oh, wait. There's a typo there. Or, you know, what kind of word is this? If you know me, you know that sometimes I come up with words and I make words up. It's part of what I do. But this is not the case. We're talking about ecclesia. We're talking about this beautiful term in the Bible, specifically in the New Testament, from the Greek language, church. Although it has kind of more depth to it than what we actually talk about when we say church. And that's what we're going to go through the month of October. But before we get there, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, you are here, and we are here at church and being the church. We pray that all the answers that we may have and all the concerns that we may have be given to you today, and that we will receive from you hope as we continue living as your church. Speak to us through your word today. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. I was glad when they said to me, let's go to the house of the Lord. That's King David writing his Psalm 122. I was glad when they told me, let's go to the house of the Lord. I pictured that yesterday. I pictured a group of teenagers there, you know, just talking about whatever teenagers talk about. Believe it or not, I'm not a teenager anymore. I don't know what I look really young, maybe with the beard a little older. I have no clue what they talk about, but I don't see any teenagers talking about, hey, let's go to church. It's a hard thing to swallow sometimes and a difficult picture to have in our minds. You know, it's not as exciting, perhaps, to go to the church as it is to go to the movie theater or a big park, maybe, especially when you're a teenager. So I picture King David coming to the teenagers and saying, oh, how awesome is it to go to church? Let's go. And everyone jumping and saying, yeah, let's go to church. That's what King David is writing in his Psalm 122. He's showing his love. He's showing his appreciation for the temple. And he is so glad that we're going to church. I once had a professor who told us, what a beautiful picture it is to see people going to church on a Sunday morning. You know where they're going. You know? All dressed nice and with a smile on their faces. What a beautiful picture. They're going to church and there's a smile on their faces. And then he went on and he said, but it's even a nicer picture, more beautiful, when they come out of church and that smile is even bigger. It's even a more beautiful picture when they come to church and when they come out the door, their faces are even better looking than when they came in. Unfortunately, there are times that we don't experience the full version of the joy that God wants to give us when we come to church. Now, I don't know if this has happened to you, but I tell you, that has happened to me. You know, there are times that we really don't take the whole package and full of joy that God wants to give us. And so many things get in the way. Unexpected visitors come. We can't make it. We're sick. We're not feeling good. Work has been hard this week. Or you're working or you're on call and you simply can't make it. Or this pandemic gets in the way. You start feeling sick and you have to stay home. There are things that that work against us, I guess. But so many times, I get in my own way. How many times do we get in our own way? With things like, it's too cold in there. No, it's too hot in there. Someone sat at my pew, Pastor. I can't hear the preacher. Or he screams all the time. I don't like that music. I don't understand the words. I'm not trying to step on anyone's toes. Let me be very clear and very specific. That's me. I go to church, and I am expecting something. And when things don't go my way, I'm talking about me. I don't feel 100%, you know, to go out with a big smile. I don't know if you have felt like that before, but I just came to the understanding that sometimes, and perhaps most of the times, I am my greatest enemy. I get in the way. You know, sometimes I wonder how y'all can sit through a sermon and stay awake. I'm preaching here, and when I'm getting ready, sometimes I feel like the message I'm giving today, it's going to take some hard, you know, work to keep people engaged. All sorts of things. Now, you're probably wondering where I'm going with all this. How often do we forget the true essence of the church, like I did 203 days ago? I forgot about the essence of the church. The fact that the church is not the building, the church is the people, as we just sang this morning. We are the church in our hymn 558. But I've been asking myself, as a pastor, as a minister, how can we, the church, continue to be the church in the same way that David is talking about in his psalm? In verse 4, he says that we must give thanks to the name of the Lord. How can we continue to be the church giving thanks to the name of the Lord? This has become, and I'm sharing my heart with you today. This has been very challenging since COVID-19 hit. Churches have, around the world, have suffered tremendously with this pandemic. And I'm sure you are aware of that. But we know that the story is not over. King David goes on to say, pray for peace. Pray. And that's what we've been doing. We've been saying, God, we want to be close with you. We want to be like this with you. And we've been praying and we've been asking for your presence. Pray for peace in this confusing time. Pray for hope and joy to flood our hearts. Pray for the many churches around the world who are unable still to go to their building. And even more for those churches who are unable to keep business going because the bills are so high. And the people aren't coming, and people cannot work, and cannot get their paycheck, and cannot give their tithe, and cannot give their offering. And many churches around the world, not just in America, around the world, are closing their doors. Pray, said David in verse 6. Pray for peace. Pray. Jesus, in the New Testament, came to church and he said, my Father said that my house is going to be called a house of what? Prayer. Not a house of fancy sermons, not a house of air conditioning, not a house of great music, a house of prayer. Now, let's be honest, we are not immune to this virus as a church. We're not talking in the individual level, and I hope you're following me. We're talking about the community of faith, the one body, the body of Christ. We are not immune. Our church has suffered too. It's been a rough year. Our church has mourned the loss of many people in the last couple of years. There are people who have passed away not long ago, this year, and we haven't been able to have a funeral service for them. And that has been tough. COVID-19 makes us cover our faces and come to church. Our community suffered with the oil bust that affected our economy. Unemployment has affected some of our families as well. And many of our friends have moved to another city, and it just leaves a gap in our hearts because we love them and we miss them. That has happened in our church. So yeah, it has been a rough year, and perhaps that has taken the smile away from our faces. To be honest, it's so hard for me to come to church and try to see who is smiling behind the mask and who is not. I like to know. You know, I like to see it. Some people you can see. Some people, they're smiling and their eyes remain the same. There's no way of knowing if he's happy or if he's mad. I don't know. It's been a rough time, people, friends, brothers, sisters, church. And whether it's not just our church, but it's the global church. And now we celebrate today a special Sunday, World Communion Sunday, as we were reminded in our prayer. Thousands and millions of Christians around the world, in the United Methodist faith especially, are celebrating this Sunday of communion. Millions of people are breaking the bread, hoping that this pandemic will be gone, and that we will be able to finally enjoy church the way it's supposed to. However, I am reminded of a hymn, a beautiful hymn and powerful hymn that is called The Church's One Foundation. The Church's One Foundation is Jesus Christ, not the Lord. Is Jesus Christ her Lord? Mid toil and tribulation and tumult of her way, she waits the consummation of peace forevermore. Till with the vision glorious her longing eyes are blessed, and the great church victorious shall be the church at rest. Yet she on hath union with God the three in one, and mystic sweet communion with those whose rest is won. O happy ones and holy, Lord, give us grace that we, like them, the meek and lowly, on high may dwell with thee. What a beautiful hymn. As we embark ourselves through a new sermon series of why you can call yourself Ecclesia, let's remember something today. Very simple, yet very powerful. We are the church. You are the church. It's not just a children thing. It's not just music from a hymnal. It's one of the greatest truths in our theology and our beliefs, that we are the church, that we are temples of the Holy Spirit. Little churches walking around HEB. How often do we invite people to church? I'm not talking about this one. I'm talking about y'all, myself. Let's remember today that we are the church, that we are His church, that we are not our own, that we do not sustain ourselves, that we do not depend on our grace, that we do not depend on our gifts, our talents, or our resources. We do not do the saving. We don't do the saving. We don't do the redeeming. We are His alone, and He will take care of us. For the whole month of October, we will be challenged to be the church, and you will hear about it. For the whole month of October, our past will be projected and shown in this foyer. If you are at home and you don't feel comfortable coming to church yet because of the big crowd, the church will be open all week for people, office hours, right, Michelle? All you have to do is ring that bell. Come, walk through the foyer. Pray as you walk through the foyer. Look at those familiar faces. If you're new to the church, look at the history of this place. Look at all the cake that people have eaten in the past 60 years. All the potlucks. all the babies being born, all the baptisms, all the deaths. Who are we as a church? Who is Asbury United Methodist Church? Who are you? Who am I? That we can call ourselves Ecclesia. This will be a turning point for our church as we prepare for next year. No one knows what's coming our way. But one thing I know, we are the church. We belong to Him, and He will take care of us. He will take care of you because He is faithful. And today we get to be reminded with a beautiful significance as we celebrate communion, as we break the bread, and we actually have a bread to break. So I invite you today to prepare your hearts for communion. And as you take from the bread and you take from the wine or the grape juice, know that the fact that we can call ourselves Ecclesia is because He bled and died for us on a cross. And that is still valid today. And that is the invitation that we little churches have every time we go to HEB. Because He died for every single one. And we have the potential to be called His church. If we can only respond to His calling. He is calling. So let's go to the Lord in prayer and prepare our hearts to celebrate Holy Communion and thank our Lord for what He has done. But not only for what He has done for us, but for who He is. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, You are the head. You, Lord, sustain us, Your church. And today we prepare our hearts for Holy Communion. Speak to us and help us, Lord, to be reminded that we can remain with You, close to You, and being the church that goes out to the world and helps people see hope, light, and joy. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. I invite you to join me today in our traditional liturgy of Holy Communion. If you're not familiar with that, we just follow our liturgy in the screens, and you can also do it through the hymnal on page 12. And I want to invite you today to be part of communion, as we see in page 12. Christ our Lord invites to His table all who love Him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved You with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done Your will. We have broken Your law. We have rebelled against Your love. We have not loved our neighbors. And we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Church, hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to You, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with Your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise Your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of Your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are You and blessed is Your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of His suffering, death, and resurrection, You gave birth to Your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread. He gave thanks to you and broke the bread, gave it to his disciples. And he said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you. He gave it to his disciples and he said, "Drink of this. And as often as you do it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. As we proclaim the mystery of faith, Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit in us, gather here, and on these gifts of bread and wine, make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Brothers and sisters, the table is open. We will celebrate communion and we will have two stations, and every single one is invited because we have been called Ecclesia. So we will have a station here and a station there. So I encourage you to follow the instructions of the ushers and enjoy being welcomed in the presence of the Lord because you get to sit at the table. So once you come, that was broken for you. And the fact that we can be called Ecclesia is because every single drop of blood was given by our Lord. We do this in remembrance of Him until He comes in final victory and we get to see Him face to face. Heavenly Father, it's because of your sacrifice through your Son, Jesus, our Lord, that we can enjoy being with you, being your church. Lord, as we discovered last month, it is not easy to be the church sometimes. Sometimes we just have to go against currents that are really strong. Sometimes we lack faith. Many times we lack the strength. We know we're not perfect. We know we need much more of you. And that's why we're here, God. Give us that conviction. Give us that assurance of your love and your grace. That when your Son, Jesus, died on that cross, He did it for every single friend that is sitting on this pew and all of those who are watching from home, who even those who couldn't take or drink this juice or eat this bread, your sacrifice, Jesus, is for them as well. That in the moment that you said, Father, it is finished, you were thinking about us. Help us remember that today. That when we come out of this place, it'll be with a smile on our faces. But a smile that understands the great privilege that we have to be called your church. A smile that says, thank you, Lord. Because though I didn't deserve it, you died for me. And now help me to share this smile with someone who needs it. To you be the glory, O foundation of our faith. In the name of Jesus Christ, our rock, we pray. Amen.
Invite you to stand with me as we sing our closing hymn, Lord, I Want to Be a Christian, that we ask for God's grace and peace and patience and love to be within each of us as we go into our worlds this week, being His church.
Church, receive the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord remind you this week that He has called you His church, that you belong to Him, that He loves you, and that He will take care of you. Go knowing that you are the church. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.